Jumbo. Good morning. Good afternoon. Today is Sunday, July 26, 2020. Here at First Community Events Incorporated, located 290 Hamilton Street, Rochester, New York, and Southwest. It's a beautiful day outside. Glad to be here. Got a lot to talk about today. We lost the brother Megger this past week. We did that. Last night, Urban CBM was laid to rest. Yesterday was the kickoff of Congressman Lewis' six-day mourning period. Well, he'll be eventually laid to rest in Atlanta before the week is out. Yesterday, he had two more services in Troy, Alabama's hometown, as well as Selma, Alabama. And then he'll be, his car will be going through the Pettus Bridge for the final time. They'll be late. This bar be in rest in U.S. Capitol for at least 2 days. And I'll put a link or information about the video. Okay. Okay. This is Wimon Oni. I'll be host for today's virtual Student Doology Hour. We'll move to the National Anthem by Sister Melinda Doolittle. Excuse me, I'm sorry. Start over again, I'm sorry.
Every voice and sing to the thing.
Amen. That was Sister Melinda Doolittle. Beautiful, beautiful version. Beautiful. I love this. Amen. Okay, also I neglected to mention earlier that yesterday was Emmett Till's 79th birthday. He'll have been 79 years old yesterday. Amen. Okay. Once again, I'm Sister William Martinoni, trustee and treasurer at the Institute in Rochester, New York. I'll be hosting once again for Verses to Indulge Hour. And this program will be our three scripture readings. First one is Isaiah 26, verse 20. It reads as follows. Come, my people, enter into thy chambers, and shut thy doors about thee. Hide thyself for a little moment, until indignation be repassed. This Bible reading is from Isaiah 41, verse 10. Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee, yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. The last verse from Isaiah 40, verse 31. But they that wait for Jehovah shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. May the Lord bless those who read his holy word. Amen. This little program is Prayer of Hope by Minister Evans. Prayer of hope, 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 prayer of hope. This is a prayer of hope. Creator, may I talk with you? The need for positive leadership is our prayer of hope. This is a prayer of hope. Too many of us feel that oppression has gone, society is no longer in the midst of chaos and conflict. This is our prayer of hope. We need our constant view to see how we see ourselves. There's need for more positive leadership. This is our prayer of hope. This reacts in the truth, the light, and the way. This is our prayer of hope. Preponderance of propaganda of the name of human relations has caused many of us to talk instead of thinking about the changes that are taking place. This is our prayer of hope. Lord, the same demonizing oppression, brutality, and second class citizenship yesterday have reconstructed itself to a new form of mechanism, namely, the perpetuation of brainwashed black people to serve oppression, brutality, second class citizenship in the name of reconciliation. This is our prayer of hope. You know, the kinds of views you see yourselves, there's need for more positive leadership. This is our prayer of hope. This is just the truth lighting away. This is our prayer of hope. Prayer of hope! Prayer of hope! Prayer of hope, prayer of hope, prayer of hope, prayer of hope. This is our prayer of hope. Amen. That was Ms. Evans' poem. That was lyric to a song by Gloucester singers. Prayer of hope. Amen. May you rest in peace, Ms. Evans. Amen. Hence, I'll do Libation on the Harlem Renaissance Fix. We were studying before the pandemic. One second. We pay homage to Nancy Hughes, the writer poet, Ashe Ashe. Arndell's a painter, Ashe Ashe. Just William Johnson, songwriter, of the very voice to sing, Ashe Ashe. Dorothy West, the writer, Ashe Ashe. All these figures are in this, featured in this book, The Pueblo Harlem Renaissance Reader. Okay, today's news update is taken from Amsterdam News. It's a two-parter about a husband and wife who supported Abolitionist John Brown. Today I'll read about the husband, Reverend James Gloucester. Next week I'll read about his wife, Elizabeth. And it's written by Herb Boyd, and it came out in the July 16th Amsterdam News. Titled, The Reverend James Gloucester, Abolitionist, Church Leader, and Herbalist. Among radical abolitionists, John Brown's most trusted supporters and benefactors was the Reverend Dr. James Gloucester. Last week in these pages, we featured his phenomenal wife, Elizabeth, who was at one time considered one of the wealthiest black women in America. Obviously, the good Reverend was not absent in his wife's exercise of property and prosperity. There was clearly the vision of labor in his prominent household. While she managed the family's businesses, Reverend Gloucester was kept the religious affairs in order. So both were extremely active in the abolitionist movement. As we shall see, the business ventures became highly contested at Elizabeth's death. James was born in 1810 in Philadelphia and was one of five children by the Reverend John and Rhoda Gloucester. Like his father, James was a pastor and the founder of the Sloan, S-L-O-A-M, Baptist Church in Brooklyn. It was one of the new independent black churches being organized in the borough in the first half of the 19th century. In 1822, same year of his death, the father, Reverend John, public schools opened in the city for blacks. As we know in profile of Elizabeth, the Gloucesters were strong advocates of John Brown's plans, and unlike some of his followers, did not end their allegiance to his cause even as it became more perilous by the time of his raid on Harper's Ferry. They provided him with some of the funds needed and opened their home to his temporary stay in Brooklyn. There was a trusted relationship, but there is little else to report about it other than that visit in the late 1850s. The son had a reputation as conductor on the Underground Railroad. For the next 30 years or so, the couple was a model family with no appearances of differences or conflict. But when Elizabeth died in 1883, things went awry, and turbulence and discord arrived, stating what had been an enviable coexistence. Excuse me. By the time of Elizabeth's death, James was no longer the pastor at Siloam and was making a living as an herbalist. Problems arose when Elizabeth's will disclosed she had bequeathed her properties to her six children. James retained an attorney and contested the will, declaring she had been under pressure at the time she wrote the will, that he was the main source of the wealth. He claimed Elizabeth used his money to acquire all the real estate and property, put all the transactions in her name. The resolution recited in probate court. One of the executors of the property's interest was the renowned Dr. James McCune Smith. Dr. Smith was one of the few that, since the killer had the children, recite in reciprocity. He was one of the first black doctors, medical doctors. Dr. Smith, along with the co-executor, an attorney, was asked to divide the estate into seven parts to be shared by James and his children. There was not a complication that after James' death, his property would be divided among his children. This became more convoluted when one of the children had been dropped from the will, which would contest the will as well. Much of the case impinged on whether James was a rebel partner during the course of the accumulation of the wealth. The dispute raged in the court and was finally settled, allowing James a lion's share of the estate with the children compromised on the case. Key to the settlement was the Remsen house that Elizabeth had run, and children assumed this duty until it was sold back to the Hampton Club, which originated. Some may have favored James, but misfortune dogged him thereafter, particularly in the future investments and various real estate ventures. When he died in 1890 at Remsen's house, he was 79 or 80, and his daughters were in attendance. Like his wife, he succumbed to pneumonia. The messy probate affair, has slid what had been for a distinguished career, highlighted by his participation in religious affairs and the abolitionist movement. He's buried near his wife in Greenwood Cemetery in Brooklyn. In remaining space, rather than pursue further James's appointments, will be given to his father, Reverend James John Gloucester, who was born in slavery and became one of the real pioneers in the Presbyterian Church in Philadelphia. At the crux of his remarkable life is the courage and determination he displayed in rescuing his wife and children from slavery. It should be noted that James was born in Philadelphia and not enslaved like his older siblings. From 1810 to 1822, John was a stalwart in the Philadelphia community. His sermons imbued with the moral turpitude that he passed on to his children, at least in the early years of their lives. His life, like his resume, is often obscured, but he was the first African American to attend Greenville College in Tennessee, where his former owner was a trustee. With stresses of purpose and devotion, he built his church and nourished his congregation with the uplifting gospel, inspiring many of them to participate in making Philadelphia a normal community of African Americans. Whether in Brooklyn or in Philadelphia, the Gloucester family was a more memorable mark. Okay, that was taken from Amsterdam News, July 16, 2020. The title article is Reverend James Gloucester, Abolitionist, Church Leader, and Herbalist. And I'll put this link around the video at the end. Amen. Very interesting story. Next week, I'll talk about his wife, Elizabeth. Amen. We'll have Bible summary next week. And I'll read Positive Institute. 1 second. Positive reads as follows. First, Community Innovations Incorporated is a spiritual and cultural organization and teaching church that promotes the development of African people. We're not a social agency, nor a social welfare agency. I represent the Code 71, but hands people liberation and determination. We treat the idea that we're a community leader can mean people do not follow. We support ISIS and intense events and programs. We refuse to give anyone a religion or ideology. Our goal is to develop dual for African people. Religious arbitrary is not accepted. This religion is the truth. There's a real ideology, is duology. The problem serves the real for our people. We should respond to demands of members and supporters, our constituency. Our constituency has the right to make demands on us. Amen. That's our positive statement. Homage to those we've lost this week. First of all, we lost Charles Evers, brother Meg Evers. He was 97 years old. He died of natural causes on July 21st, I believe it is. He was the mayor of Fayetteville, Mississippi, 1969. He was the first black mayor in Mississippi. He also divorced registration after his brother passed. Also ran for Congress at one point. And 97 Miss Evers became the first African American candidate for the Mississippi. Also, he lost a sister who most people didn't know. She was a producer and journalist for the Good Morning America TV show. That's on ABC, now called GMA. Her name was Daisha Riley. She was 35 years old. She passed unexpectedly. And on GMA, if you don't watch it regularly, they do have two black correspondents, Robin Roberts and Malcolm Strahan. And they were very praised with her on TV when they announced the president on Tuesday. And sister won multiple Emmy Awards for work on GMA. Now it's those who passed from COVID. As of yesterday, 283 Monroe County residents we lost due to COVID. And nice as a whole, we have now over 146,000 Americans. 146,000. 146,000 plus because your presence and confidence. Now he realized that people must go to mass. Now he's doing the daily breathing by himself. He had to cancel his convention in Jacksonville because Florida coronavirus situation is ridiculous. But still wants to go to school in the fall. But his child probably going to school in the fall, his own child. His question probably going to go to school back in the fall. Who else is going to go to school in the fall? And today's 2 hours, listen to y'all. Remember that, too. Sons, please, for the Evers family, Brother Everett, Sister Daisha. Our condolences go to their families and all those in our community and nationwide who just due to COVID. Let's have a moment of silence, please. Amen. May God rest in peace. Okay, next Sunday we'll resume service outdoors. We're calling Student Doology Hour in the yard, be in the backyard. August 2nd, 4 p.m. Hopefully it'll be very nice. Well, we have the president be very nice. The backyard is mostly trees, so it shouldn't be too hot Sunday afternoons. Okay. And the protocol is on the website, on the blog, srrochers.org. I'll read the protocol. 1 second. Okay, this is the blog post. It's on our blog now, srrochers.org. For the August 2nd, 2020, First Community Infants Incorporated, resume in-person Student Doology Hour worship service on Sunday afternoon in the backyard of 20 Hampton Street. In a short time format and limited in-person capacity, as long as the weather permits. There'll be 10 seats outside, 6 feet apart. We'll continue the First Student Doology Hour on this YouTube channel. So we'll do both. We'll have the online service, because everybody's not ready to come back to these two quite yet, even outdoors. Some of us are not ready to come back, and that's understandable. So we'll continue the YouTube format, because there's a need for that, and people do enjoy it. We thank you for your patience during this mandated New York State shutdown. In response to the reopening survey, have made this step possible. For New York State and CDC guidelines, these are the rules that will be followed for Student Doology Hour in the yard. 1, masks must be worn for entire service. Masks must be provided at entry. Hand sanitizer must be applied immediately. We'll have a bottle on the table, a large bottle. Next to the hand sanitizer bottle will be envelopes with donation. Find the one with your name on it and put your donation in the red box. And if you so decide, you put change in the cup. To minimize Brother Sal's and Brother Brian's exposure to people, we're going to do like that. We'll have everything on the table. So put your money in your envelope and whatnot when you first come in. Need to take it to your chair and figure what you're going to do, put your money in, whatever. You can do that, but please put an envelope in the box yourself. We will not be serving food. It's not safe to do right now. Please not bring food to the Institute. Do not bring food to the Institute. We will have bottled water available on the table. It shows that you eat at home for the service. No hugs or handshakes. Wave the group when we enter the yard. Children disinfected before and after service. commonly designated birthday commemoration. Debated honoree honorees will receive a birthday card, small token, and box either donuts, muffins, cupcakes. We will not have cake and ice cream. There are people who will be other folks that walk on Hamlin Street and going through the parking lot not wearing masks. Mainly our allies, if you want to call them that. You'd be surprised when many folks come down, going down Hamilton Street. You have most folks not wearing masks. The walking the dogs not wearing masks. It's crazy. So, in that regard, after service, please leave as soon as possible. We'll try to keep it with an hour format, maybe hour 50 minutes. Probably this Sunday, because it's been so long since we met. Probably a little longer, probably an hour and a half, so we can see what everybody's doing for the past few months. But we'll try to keep within an hour. So please come early. Last part is very important. Please stay home if you're sick or if you've been exposed to someone with COVID-19. Okay, so masks are mandatory. You want to wear a face shield or hazmat suit or goggles, whatever makes you more comfortable, please, that's up to you, but masks are definitely mandatory for sure. Okay, I apologize if some of these procedures are antisocial, but we're dealing with antisocial situation. COVID-19 disease where you have pretty much stay home by yourself, stay healthy. If you get sick, you stay home by yourself. In the house, you're pretty much by yourself. It is what it is. So hopefully these procedures will keep us safe while we're outside for at least the next month or so until it gets cooler for us to be outside. August 16th is Marcus Garvey fundraiser. August 16th. And focus on bottles. So try to get folks in your circle. Don't put in the Saturday bottle campaign to give bottles on the 16th. Now, one more Black Lives Matter sign left. If you want it, please let me know ASAP for it. I give it away. You can use PayPal to the Institute. And link is paypal.me/FCIIROC. And please complete your census questionnaire. See, our response rate is very, very low. It's under 50%. You gotta bring up a notch in our community. The white folks in the suburbs are doing their census. The county census response rate is around 67%. But the city is down on 50%. If you want resources in the city, you gotta do the census. Bottom line, we complain why certain things in the suburbs, not in the city, that's the reason why. If you're not counted, you don't exist, period. So please do your census online at my20census.gov, call 844-330-2020. They're gonna start sending folks out in 2 weeks to people's houses knock on doors. So if you want people, someone knocking your door, please go online or call 844-330-2020. Amen. Now we do Psalm 23. Bless my shepherd shall not want. Make me lie down in green pastures. He beside still waters. He restored my soul. Leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, you run thy staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. And surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. May the Lord bless us with his holy word. That was Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. We'll close with our four songs of hope and comfort. Lean on me by Bill Withers. Heaven was over Stevie Wonder, excuse me. She should call my Sam Cooke. And people get raped by Curtis Mayfield, not order. Lean on me by Bill Withers.
child, never had a home. Heaven help the girl who walks the streets alone. Heaven help the roses if the bombs begin to fall. Heaven help us all. Heaven help the black man if he struggles one more day. Heaven help the white man if he turns his back away. Heaven help the man who kicks the man as the crow. Heaven help us all. Heaven help us all. Heaven help us all. Heaven help us, Lord, here I call. When we fall, oh, yeah. Heaven help the boy that won't reach 21. Heaven help the man that gave that boy a gun. Heaven help the people with their backs against the wall. Heaven help us all. Heaven help us. Oh, oh, yeah. Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. Heaven, oh, help us all, Lord.
Movie, and I go downtown.
Last song was Chris Mayfield, People Get Ready. Rest in peace, Brother Curtis Mayfield, Brother Sam Cook, and Brother the Withers. May I was in heaven. I thank all those who chat with me during the week. Please can check on me during the week. This concludes First Student Doology Hour for Sunday, July 26, 2020. I love you all. Please check up on each other during the week. Please check on those who need a little help. Hope to see you all either online next Sunday the 2nd, or in the yard, 20 Hamlin Street, August 2nd, 4 p.m. Please be careful during the week. Wash your hands. Social distance. When you're out somewhere, 6 feet apart. Wear your mask, wear your mask, wear your mask. Wash your hands, wash your hands, wash your hands. Be very careful. Amen. I'll see you all next week. Online or in the yard. Love you all. Have a good week. God bless.